Welcome to the course Topics in Database Systems and Design. So this session is actually organized as it will give you some overview of the entire course and also will give some introduction to the fundamental aspects of the course. So we can move to the content. This is how it is organized. First, it will cover some course overview like course outcomes, syllabus of the entire course and the textbooks to be followed. And then it will give some introduction to the database systems. Now coming to course outcomes, after learning this course, you would be able to design database system using ER modeling. Then you would be able to understand the relational model by relational algebra and also will be able to apply principles of database design for creating good databases. Also you will be able to understand the significance of data mining for doing research in that area. And you will be able to extract information from relational database using SQL. I also will be able to develop simple programs using PL/bar SQL language. Now coming to the entire organization of this course, entire syllabus or entire subject is divided into 6 different modules. And the first module is dealing with the introduction part of the entire course. Like it will cover the conceptual data modeling using ER modeling. Then covers the relational model concepts, then relational model constraints and relational database schemas, then the corresponding relational languages, those are relational algebra, tuple calculus and domain relational calculus. All these 3 languages will be covered. And finally, a mapping of relational database design using ER to relational mapping. So these are the different contents of module 1. Now coming to module 2, it is about normalization and all. So relational database design algorithms will be covered here. Different functional dependencies will be discussed and different normal forms based on functional dependencies and keys like 1NF, 2NF, etc. will be covered. Finally, the multi-value dependencies and 4th normal forms will be discussed. And last, the join dependencies and 5th normal form also will be covered. Module 3 is SQL, that is data definition, constraints, basic queries and updates, embedded SQL, stored procedures and triggers, types of triggers, different operations or triggers, all those will be covered in module 3. And module 4 is about object-oriented databases. So introduction to this object-oriented database concepts will be covered first. Then object relational features and object data model of this corresponding object oriented database, that is ODMG, and the corresponding data language, data manipulation and query languages will be covered. Module 5 is about data mining technologies. So different data mining technologies, different algorithms will be discussed here, and then data warehousing and all up will be discussed then, architectures, data modeling for warehouses, building data warehouse like that will be discussed. Then functionalities of data warehouse also will be discussed in module 5. And finally in module 6, the Oracle database will be covered. The organization and architecture of Oracle database and little bit programming in Oracle using PL/bar SQL also will be covered in module 6. And then the textbooks you have to follow to learn this course. For the database aspects, you have to follow the text authored by Ramiz Almasri and Shamkant Nawadi. The textbook title, Database Systems, Models, Languages, Design and Application Programming, 6th edition. And for data mining techniques, you have to follow the text by Han and Kimber. Textbook titled, Data Mining Concepts and Techniques, 2007 edition. And this course really urges for a prerequisite, that is, the fundamentals of database in your BTech program. So we have to build upon those concepts you have already learned in your BTech. Anyway, let us have a quick recap on the basic ideas or basic fundamental things required to learn this course. Types of databases and database applications. As we know, databases and database systems are an essential component of our daily life nowadays, right? Every day we will involve some interaction with the databases. For example, if you want to withdraw some money from a bank or if you want to purchase something online or even purchasing items at a supermarket often automatically updates the database that holds the inventory of grocery items, right? So these interactions are examples of what we may usually call as traditional database applications. In such databases, most of the information that is stored and accessed is either textual or numeric. So those are called numeric and textual databases, in which data will be of either numeric or textual characteristics. Okay. Now, recent technologies have led to exciting new applications of database systems. And these technologies made possible to store images, audio clips and video streams even digitally in a database. So these types of databases are called multimedia databases. Another category of databases also there, that is geographic information system, or GIS in short, which can store and analyze maps, weather data, satellite images, etc. And then we have data warehouses, which are the systems used in many companies to extract and analyze useful business information from a very large database to support decision making. And then we have real-time and active databases used to control industrial and manufacturing processes. As a quick recap, let us go through the basic definitions. Like database, which is a collection of related data, and data, which are the known facts that can be recorded and have an implicit meaning. And just for example, names, telephone numbers, address of people, etc. are the examples for data. And a mini world. So a database represents some aspects of the real world, and sometimes this is called mini world or the universe of discourse. So definitely changes in the mini world are reflected in the database. Then database management system, or DBMS in short. So which is a collection of programs that enable users to create and maintain a database. So a DBMS is usually a general purpose software system that facilitates the process of defining, constructing, manipulating and sharing databases among various users and applications. And then the database system, the DBMS software together with the data itself can be called as the database systems. Sometimes the database application also will be included in this database system. Now the typical functionalities of a DBMS software. First functionality is defining a database. So defining a database involves specifying the data types, structures and constraints of the data to be stored in the database. So data definition, or this descriptive information, is also stored by the DBMS in the form of a database catalog or dictionary, which is called metadata. Now the second functionality is constructing a database. So constructing a database is the process of storing the data on some storage medium that is controlled by the database management system. And the third one is manipulating the database, like functions such as querying the database to retrieve specific data, updating the database to reflect changes in the mini world, and generating reports from the data, etc. And finally, sharing the database allow multiple users and programs to access database simultaneously in a consistent and valid way. Then some other features like protection and security of this database from unauthorized accesses. Then active processing, just for example, if you want to increment the salary of an employee every year. So such internal operations will be there. And presentation and visualization of data. So these are the typical functionalities of a database management system. To learn different aspects, we have chosen an example database, which is a university database. So we can say that the mini world in our case is a part of a university environment. So different entities are there, just for example, students, courses, sections of courses, departments, instructors, etc. So the university database maintains information about different students and courses, grades, etc. in a university environment. So these are some examples for relationship between different entities, like sections are of specific courses, or students take sections, so take is relationship here, or courses have prerequisite courses, instructors teach sections, courses are offered by departments, students major in departments. So whatever shown in italics is the relationship name. We can go through it detail later. Before moving on to the topic, let us have a discussion on the characteristics of the database approach. So mainly let us compare that with the traditional file processing method. A number of characteristics distinguish the database approach from the much older approach of programming with files. In a traditional file processing, each user defines and implements the files needed for a specific software application as part of programming the application. Just for example, one user, say the grade reporting office, may keep files on students and their grades. So programs to print the student's transcript and to enter new grades are implemented as part of this application. Another user, say accounting office, may keep track of students' fees and their payments. Although both users are interested in data about the student, each user maintains a separate files and a set of programs to manipulate these files. So this will definitely lead to redundancy in information. So this redundancy in defining and storing data results in wasted storage space and in redundant efforts to maintain common up-to-date data. Whereas in a database approach, a single repository maintains data that is defined once and then accessed by various users. So if we try to list out different characteristics of database, these are the characteristics. First one is self-describing nature of a database system. So a fundamental characteristics of the database approach is that the database system contains not only the database itself, but also a complete definition or description of the database structure and constraints. So this definition is stored in the DBMS catalog, which contains information such as the structure of each file, the type and storage format of each data item, and various constraints on the data. The information stored in the catalog is called metadata, and it describes the structure of the primary database. So second characteristic is the insulation between programs and data. In a traditional file processing, the structure of data files is embedded in the application programs. So any changes to the structure of a file may require changing all programs that access that file. By contrast, in case of DBMS, the DBMS access programs do not require such changes in most cases. The structure of the data files is stored in the DBMS catalog separately from the access programs. So we can call this property as program data independence. In some types of database systems, such as object-oriented databases, users can define operations on data as part of the database definition itself. So an operation is usually specified in two different parts. First part is the interface of an operation, which includes the operation name and the data types of its arguments. And the second part is the implementation, which is specified separately and can be changed without affecting the interface. So user application programs can operate on the data by invoking these operations through their names and arguments, regardless of how the operations are actually implemented. So we can call this as program operation independence. So two different types of independence, program data independence and program operation independence. Now another characteristic that allows program data independence and program operation independence is called data abstraction. So a DBMS provides users with a conceptual representation of data that does not include many of the details of how the data is actually stored or how the operations are actually implemented. This conceptual representation is called data model, and which uses logical concepts like objects, their properties and their interrelationships that may be easier for most users to understand than computer storage concepts. Hence, the data model hides storage and implementation details that are not of interest to most database users. Another important characteristic is support to multiple views of the data. So a database typically have many users and each of whom may require a different perspective or view of the database. Usually a view may be a subset of the database or it may contain some virtual data which is derived from the database files, but it's not explicitly stored. So based on the requirement or viewpoint of different users, database support multiple views of the data. You can see example for those views later. Another important characteristic is that sharing of data and multi-user transaction processing. So a multi-user DBMS, as its name implies, must allow multiple users to access the same database at the same time. Usually this will be essential if data for multiple applications is to be integrated and maintained in a single database. So DBMS here must include concurrency control software to ensure that several users trying to update the same data and they do in a controlled manner so that the result of the updates is correct. Just for example, when several reservation agents try to assign a seat on an airline flight, the DBMS should ensure that each seat can be accessed by only one agent at a time for assignment to a passenger. These types of applications are generally called online transaction processing, or OLTP in short. So the fundamental role of multi-user DBMS software is to ensure that concurrent transactions operate correctly and efficiently. So to support this, the DBMS must enforce several transaction properties like isolation, atomicity, etc. Isolation property ensures that each transaction appears to execute in isolation from other transactions, even though hundreds of transactions may be executing concurrently. And atomicity property ensures that either all the database operations in a transaction are executed or none are executed. So we can discuss all those things later in detail. Now let us go through different uses of a database environment. For a small personal database such as the list of addresses, one person typically defines, constructs and manipulates the database, and there won't be any sharing, right? However, in large organizations, many people are involved in the design, use and maintenance of a large database. With how we can find two different categories of people. One category whose job involves the day-to-day use of large database, those are called actors on the scene. And the second category, people who may be called workers behind the scene, who work to maintain the database system environment but are not actively interested in the database contents as part of their daily job. So actors on the scene and workers behind the scene. Let us go through each one in detail. Coming to the actors on the scene, database administrators, database designers and end users comes under this category. Database administrators. So in any organization where many people use the same resources, there is a need for a chief administrator to oversee and manage these resources. So in a database environment, the primary resource is the database itself, and the secondary resource is the DBMS and related software. Administering those resources is the responsibility of the database administrator, or DBA in short. So this DBA is responsible for authorizing access to the database, coordinating and monitoring its use, and acquiring software and hardware resources as needed. So definitely this DBA is accountable for problems such as security breaches and poor system response time. In very large organizations, the DBA is assisted by a staff that carries out this function. Now the database designers, they are responsible for identifying the data to be stored in the database and for choosing appropriate structures to represent and store this data. So these database designers communicate with all prospective database users in order to understand their requirements and to create a design that meets all these requirements. So the final design, database design, must be capable of supporting the requirements of all user groups. Now the end users. So end users are the people whose jobs require to access the database for querying, updating and generating reports. We can say that the database exists primarily for the use of end users. So there are different categories of end users. First category is casual users. So these types of users occasionally access the database, but they may need different information each time. Usually they use some sophisticated database query language to specify their requests. Second category is naive or parametric users. So we can say that A large section of the entire end user populations comes under this category. So they will use some previously well-defined functions in the form of scan transaction against the database. Just for example, bank tellers check account balance and post withdrawal and deposits. Like reservation agents for airlines, hotels and car rental companies check availability for a given request and make reservation. Those types of users comes under naive or parametric end users. And the next category is sophisticated end users, which includes engineers, scientists, business analysts, etc. Usually they use some tools in the form of software packages to access the database. And finally, we have standalone users. Those maintain personal databases by using ready-made program packages that provide easy-to-use menu-based or graphics-based interfaces. Just for example, the user of a tax package that stores a variety of personal financial data for tax purposes. An example for standalone user. In the next session, we will go through the different phases of database design, and we will go through the conceptual design of a database using ER modeling in detail. Thank you.